So if we look back to what happened in Ukraine during Tachvatat, the Cossacks, Ukrainian Cossacks, were breaking off the Polish Empire, and for some reason they saw the Jewish people as their enemy, because I think the Jewish people are loyal to the local government, and the local government was Polish. So they saw, oh, you're not loyal to the local government, so therefore you're our enemy. And they killed.
They said, you are local to the loyal government.
You are loyal to the local government.
And the Cossacks were overthrowing the local government, so therefore the Jews were the opponent. Yeah, okay.
Were the opponent. And they killed a third of the Jewish people, sent them into slavery, a whole generation of orphans which didn't have an education. And that's why you had a very big divide in the Jewish community from then onwards, more than before, of uneducated Jewish people and the educated people. And then the Baal Shem Tov, they were basically traumatized from this. A whole generation of people that grew up without any education. And they were traumatized, sleeping like a traumatized person. And the Baal Shem Tov came along and lifted the spirits of all those people that were uneducated as a result of what happened a generation or two before. It was already like two generations by the time the Baal Shem Tov. So this trauma was entrenched. It was intergenerational trauma that was entrenched by the time the Baal Shem Tov was dealing with it, and he lifted the spirits of the regular people, and this created the Hasidic movement. And we see the loyalty of the Hasidim. All the Hasidim are connected to the Baal Shem Tov as the original leader of the Hasidic movement, and you see their loyalty to learning and to doing mitzvahs, and their precision in and their devotion surpasses even the scholars, and they themselves became scholars over time. So what happened is people were afraid to live in the shtetls at that time. So we're looking in the middle of the 1600s, and they were afraid to live in the shtetls because there's no protection. If a person's living on the prairie somewhere, or they're living somewhere, this was a big problem with the pioneers that went into the prairie, that they didn't have an army protecting them, so the Indians would assassinate them, and they needed to have forts with soldiers in order to protect them. Otherwise, they're going to be wiped out, and that's what happened to the Jewish people living in Ukraine by the Ukrainian Cossacks at that time. And so people thought to themselves, strength is with numbers, and they're going to live in the cities. So they went to Vilna. At least in the cities, there's a wall, there's an army, there's protection. The problem was that this was before manufacturing, and there really wasn't a way to make money in the cities. The way to have income is to farm, have a bit of land and to grow vegetables, and then to trade with that, and to have some goats, and to have a cow, and to have, that's the way to make an income at that time. So if people go into the cities, they're just continuing this trap of poverty and lack of education. And the Baal Shem Tov started to encourage people to go back to the farms, go live on the land, trust in Hashem, grow your own food. And it was prophetic, because there wasn't another massacre of like that till a few hundred years later, in the 1650, 1750, 1850, 1919, it was almost 300 years exactly. And what happened is that the Alter Rebbe after him encouraged people to farm, and the Mittler Rebbe, his son, also invested monies that they should buy properties in Kherson. Kherson was now in the news, but it was a place which wasn't inhabited, and he encouraged people, go take the land and grow food in these fields, go live on the land, don't need to live in the big cities, and you'll be able to have an income, you'll trust in God, eventually they're going to become more prosperous, they'll be able to pay for their sons-in-laws to study in yeshiva, and they're going to be scholars over time. That was a way to solve the problem. And then what happened in the 41, 42, especially 43, is that the people that lived, this is many generations of prosperity, spiritual prosperity, the most beautiful time of emotional prosperity, where people grew emotionally in their relationship with Hashem and the relationship with others and the kindness they did to each other. Until today, you see the tremendous kindness organizations from the Hasidic communities. But what happened at that time? People started to move into the cities, that's true. But the people that lived in the rural areas were the first targeted, the first by the Nazis. And even though they didn't know how to tell who is a Jew and who isn't a Jew, but the local population did. So everybody was in constant fear that they're going to be hunters. Local people that are hunters of Jews, and they're going to, even if they're incognito living on a farm, these hunters are going to come to the farm, they're going to notice them, then they're going to do the work themselves, they're going to bring the Nazis, and they're going to be shot. And these areas in Ukraine were the people were shot. And actually the witnesses of Treblinka, that the most of the SS guards were not Germans, they were Ukrainians, they were Lithuanians, they had the SS uniforms, but they had a different patch and a different color uniform. So in a way, history repeated itself, that it was safer in the city, but in the end, being in the city also wasn't safe, because they just made transports of all the people in the cities. That's in Poland, but in Ukraine, they just walked them out outside of the city. They tired them overnight. They kept them in a place without food and water so that people wouldn't resist. And the next morning, they walked them up out to a mass grave. That's what generally happened in the areas where there is no train system that matches the European train system. In other words, the size of the tracks of Russia are a different size than the tracks of the rest of Europe. So it wasn't practical to make transports. So they just made these mass graves. They matched them to these mass graves. But who was able to successful are the people that left early enough. The people that had the foresight to just leave the area early enough, then if they had the money, their funding to be able to leave, because no country wanted them. So if they had the funding to be able to leave early enough, those people were safe, and also people that ran into the forests as groups. In other words, strength is with numbers, but they went into the forest and they became partisans, and they became a fighting force, because even local partisans would wipe them out. So they needed to be a fighting force in the forest, but there's no food in the forest. So they needed to be able to go to the farms. The food is in the farms. They need to visit the farms and to be able to collect resources. And one of the best stories that I heard of a person that I know, that I knew really well, is that his family lived in Vilna, which is a city by the war. And his sister and brother, two brothers and a sister, they just took a cow before the war came. They realized it's going to come. They took a cow and they walked the cow in deep into Russia. So they basically had a food creating machine with them. The food machine ate the grass. They had the milk. They didn't go hungry because that would be a very big problem. And they literally walked the cow deep into Russia and they were saved from the whole problem because they took their food generating machine with them. That was like one of the best most successful survivor stories that I heard. Whereas the fellow that I knew, it was impossible. He was caught. He was shot at. They all had to take off their clothes and they stood by the ditch. They were shot at, and he managed to jump in before he was shot. Then he had all these the corpses on top of him. They've kept on firing, but somehow he was deep enough that he wouldn't take the bullets. And eventually he climbed out at nighttime and he tried. There was a pile of clothes. He couldn't find his clothes. He took any clothes. And he went on his track. Of course, he was caught again, and he ended up working as a tailor of German uniforms till the end of the war in one of the camps outside of Auschwitz. And that's how he survived. So that's just a story. I'm just pointing out that people may think that safety is with numbers, but actually for 300 years, the best thing spiritually was to live in the more people living in the country, growing their own food, being outside of everything. That was the best strategy. But again, that's not a strategy because people in the country are very vulnerable. So as soon as, you know, Hashem decided that the government was evil, unless they ran into the forest with a fighting force, that didn't work anymore. Just pointing that out, but it took a few hundred years till that became a problem again. That's I just want to point that out.
Thank you, Rabbi Chirik. So what do you suggest we could learn about that for our times?
I really like the idea of people, you know, moving to these rural locations and having access to their own food. The more people that do it, the bigger the communities in these farm locations. I think that's the better. But I also think that activism and speaking out is extremely, extremely important, because when you see like a psychological operation being done on the youth, that is that's a red flag. Just like in the Germany 1930s, you started to see a psychological operation being done on the people that was absurd, but people just like accepted it. You see people who just follow like sheep. So nowadays, if we see the psychological operation, we can't just sit by, because that doesn't work. You can't say, oh, people will rebel and everything will just pass a few months. That's what they thought then. It didn't work. When they did the psychological operation, it lasted for many, many years. And if Russia and America wouldn't have captured all that ground, there wouldn't be very many survivors left, because they were doing such a job of wiping everybody off. It was just an absolute miracle that these survivors survived till the Americans and the Russians liberated the camps. So I'm saying, don't wait till something crazy happens with the youth. If something has to be, people need to be really active. They can't just run away to their place and think they can't be active. People have to speak out and educate and be active and reach out to the youth. And it's important to have as much as possible normal, healthy youth, normal, healthy kids. What do you say?
So I think the first thing is to learn. It's really all in the hands of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Holy One, blessed be He, God Almighty. There's no alternative. You could see, you could try this, you could try that. In terms of the where to go, the attitude has to be, you have to be going without fear. It has to be, I trust that God Almighty is going to take care of me. I don't know how to, you know, you talk about the people with the cow and the having their own food producing machine, the cow. I don't know how to use a cow. I don't know how to feed a cow. I don't know how to take care of a cow. I don't even know how to milk the cow. Okay, tell me, let me learn how. And so there's an attitude of, I think first has to have an attitude of realism, meaning to say, not an attitude of fear and terror, but realism, meaning to say, and if someone says, well, that's never going to happen. Well, they are losing the opportunity to maybe learn a new skill or learn something that could be useful at some point in time. And what we need to do is we have to have the humility to acknowledge that there's nothing that can happen. We see from the Rebbe that the Rebbe's approach is to know that anything could happen. And at the same time, move ahead with his implementation of his vision as if nothing bad is going to happen. So when the Rebbe was asked that could a Holocaust happen in America, God forbid, he said tomorrow morning. And they said that the Rebbe had a suitcase packed with the most precious handwritten manuscripts of the previous Lubavitcher Rebbe, always, because he was ready that in a moment's notice, if he had to flee and there was only one thing he could take with him, he was going to take this suitcase of manuscripts. So he was not assuming anything about the stability of the American government, the stability of American society, all that. Anyone who thinks that is foolish. And it's also interesting, by the way, I think this really touches on something very deep, because we have to admit, if we have humility, our own fragility. Meaning to say, any one of us, and the Torah teaches us this, any person should not feel confident in his certainty of his making the right next choice at any time and any place. Meaning to say, we have free choice at all times and all places. But I cannot look at anything that anyone else is doing and saying, I could never do that. Given the right combination of thoughts, I, as a human being created by God Almighty in his image, could do anything. I have free choice to do that. That's a very humbling realization. I'm not above any type of conduct. Anything the Torah says, don't do, is not beyond me doing. That's just a fact of the way that God Almighty created the creation, created me, created all of us. And also anything good he says to do is not beyond me to do either. So when someone says, oh, nothing could ever happen. Oh, that's just, you're just being, unnecessarily cautious, or you're overreacting, or, oh, look, you think that's going to happen in America? Those people also could have the same idea about themselves. What some people are doing over there with themselves or with their children or how they're indoctrinating themselves, that's not relevant to, they're saying, to their own selves in their own place where they are protecting themselves and thinking that it's not relevant to them. But the fact of the matter is that we all stand the potential of being exposed to something that's going to suddenly trigger something in our mind. We're going to go off doing something that we would have thought is absolutely absurd. We would never do it. But the fact of the matter is, we could do it. So what does that mean? That means that we have to take seriously what the Torah tells us, to take precautions about what we ingest, what our eyes see, what we hear, what we contemplate, what we what we ruminate on, what we entertain, because it really could, we could be just swept away in the stream in an instant. So when you have that humility about yourself, or when a person has their humility about themselves, the end result is that you could look at a population of people who are all good people, but they too could suddenly get swept away in some frenetic fear that someone's the enemy, or some idea that there's so much danger there they can't protect their neighbors, or the Jews are the enemy, or the tall people or the short people are the enemy. Anything can be put on people. Look, within the last few years, there was a raging mental illness going around saying that people who breathe are the enemy. So you would say to yourself, come on, that's how absurd could it be that there would be seize the mental population by their, mental faculties would suddenly be believing that the people who breathe are the enemy, I mean, don't we all breathe? Isn't that like basic things? Never mind saying whether or not you like Jews or whether or not you like people like this or people like that. No one would ever think that people who breathe are the problem. And yet, for an entire population, the people who breathe were defined as the enemy. Oh, he's breathing. He's not taking proper precautions that his breathing is not, you know, contaminating the rest of the people. And he's a life-threatening danger to the entire population. So it shows you, now we, if we have humility, we can recognize that any one of us can fall into that kind of thinking in an instant. In fact, you might even think already that your food is dangerous, your air is dangerous, your water is dangerous, other people are dangerous. I mean, you could have all kinds of ideas going in your head about how dangerous the world is. And, or could be swept up in thinking, oh, well, that's not a problem because it's never going to affect me. But all of a sudden, a person could be affected. So what's occurring to me while we're talking about this is that the Rebbe, when you have true humility, you know that you are one thought away. Every one of us is one thought away from making a choice that, yet today we say, I'd never do that. So the Rebbe sees that every human being has that free choice. And not only that, you add another layer of issue. If you understand that God Almighty is running the world exactly as he wants it, and maybe it's necessary for a person to, or a population to go through, God forbid, something that's going to shake up their slumbering and so forth, then also you would see, who knows what God has in store? How are we supposed to know? Who's able to say that? Because if you had the inside secrets and you know that God Almighty is not going to do anything in the next, you've got it figured out. Who am I to argue with you? Maybe you got the inside secrets. But if you're telling me that the reason that we're all safe is because America has been around for 250 years and nothing could go wrong, who are you fooling? There's been no country in the world that lasted that long. Look at Tanakh.
So you're basically saying it's a paradox and it's a constant challenge, because on the other hand, you have to, on one hand, we are very dependent on Hashem, and we have to can't think that things are dangerous, and we can't be. Can't be in a state of fear that the water is dangerous, the air is dangerous. On the other hand, we at the same time have to treat the threats extremely seriously. We have to make moves. We don't know if they're going to be successful. You have to make them fast. You know what I mean? Like, if something's a threat, we have to like address that threat in a way that's within our power. The faster the better. On the other hand, we know that we're totally in the hands of Hashem, and it's really not a threat. So it's like it's a both. It's really a living paradox that we treat things extremely seriously. At the same time, we have total trust in Hashem.
I think that's beautiful. I think that's beautifully said. And I just wanted to make one point. It's about Tanakh. In the Torah, the Jewish people are going through these like constant, almost like 40-year cycles. You know, things are, they're spiritually attuned and they lose sight of things and stuff like that. So 250 years is already like an order of magnitude. And by the way, the spiritual erosion was already occurring immediately in the 1700s. I mean, they've been trying to erode and undermine everything that we think that America is based on, has been attacked from the very beginning. And the education system, the whole creation of public schooling was for the purpose to be able to infiltrate ideas and push in literature and push in standardized learning programs that were going to take people to where they are now. Nothing that's happening today was not foreseen back then. So yes. To go back to your point, yes, we have to have both things at the same time. And that comes to the humility. It really comes to the humility, because if Hashem presents me an opportunity to understand how to change a tire, I can't say, well, that's beneath me. I will never need to know how to change a tire because I have AAA. That's like an act of deflecting the opportunity to learn something. Maybe I don't have to become an expert in it. Maybe I don't have to occupy my day all day learning how to change a tire. But there will, could come a time when I'm on the road, there's so, no cell phone coverage, and there is no way to reach AAA, and maybe there's no one else on the road. So I need to know how to change a tire. And same with all these different things in life. So going back to your point with this, what are the Rebbe is saying about going and becoming farmers is get back to the basic responsibility of I am learning how to harness the tremendous creative power of God Almighty's creation. I'm learning how to harness that for the benefit of mankind, which is the commandment in the Torah that we have to conquer the earth and bring it to the richness and the abundance of the earth to the forefront to be of service to God Almighty and to human people, human beings, right? So having that humility. So that's really what it's about. It's go back to the land.
Now going back to the importance of neighbors, that you have a good neighbor, but really the neighbors would literally call in the Germans to shoot their good neighbors. But there were few that hit people on risk of terrible peril, and even some people hit. But then afterwards they turned their coats. Whereas in other places like Czechoslovakia, it was much more likely to find people that would be helpful. So we see that we need good neighbors that have the fundamentals, that are really deep down good people, that that a principle of kindness is something that's deeply inside them. Another thing that we see is a lesson from the Warsaw Ghetto uprising. They did a very good uprising. The one thing that they didn't calculate was an escape strategy. I'm just saying that they basically planned to the point, like, we're here. They never had like the next move. And I think one of the things we learned from the Rebbe that he always has a next move ready. He's already planned out the next move and the next move and the next move afterwards. So that's something also very important.
I just want to say with the polls, I think that one of the propagandas that one of the Nazi propagandas is to teach us to believe, and really the fundamental propaganda against the Jews is for the Jews to believe that the world is hostile. So every time we see anti-Semitism in the world, that's really being created as theatrics for us to believe that the world is not a safe place. And then we'll turn to the government. In fact, the Nazis were seen as rescuers in many situations because they were going to protect. So I suspect a lot of this, the propaganda that they portray of the Polish people as being generally anti-Semitic is false. And, you know, if you think about it, the escape, as I understand it, the escape from the Warsaw Ghetto, all of the people that were able to be secreted out were through non-Jewish houses in the outside the walls of the ghetto. So there was a tremendous amount of support. There was an entire Polish army operating underground, continuing to resist the Nazis. There was Polish intelligence continued to fight the Nazis.
And yes, and true. And the Polish, there was a certain Polish army, which I heard testimony that that worked together with the Warsaw Uprising. Like, where did they get the weapons from? They got it from the Polish army. And even the Polish army, they got it from London. They got help from London. So there's always somebody's helping. Nobody can do it on their own. And I think that's an important lesson, that people think that I'm going to do this, I'm going to be safe all my own. No, you need help. You know what I mean? There's always
help. Yeah. You know, it's a team effort. It's really
a team effort. Yeah.
And I think that what you're saying is so important about, you know, the Rebbe's always got the next move, meaning to say, but that he wants us to think, then what's the next move? The next move is always speaking up and making a protest against what's going on, because people become afraid that by speaking up, they're going to become targeted. And as a matter of fact, people who speak up the most are not the ones who are in the greatest danger. And in fact, if you look at the whole Torah is based on people who were attacked for their beliefs. I mean, every one of our forefathers was attacked for their beliefs. Every one of our prophets was attacked for his beliefs, attacked by his own people, attacked by people physically, said nasty things to them, attempts to kill them, starve them, everything you could possibly imagine. So if a person is afraid of that, any of those consequences, then he is not yet expressing the essence of what it means to be alive in God Almighty's world, and particularly to have the merit to be born as a child of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I think that's why the Rebbe puts so much emphasis on this concept of the Yechidah Sheba Nefesh, the central core place of the soul that's one with God Almighty, because and the level of what's called Mesiras Nefesh, of sacrifice of the soul, meaning to say that the soul goes, expresses that there is no separation between me and God. That is what the Rebbe emphasizes so much in the Maimarim, not as merely as a talking about the wonders of being a child of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but rather teaching us how to practically approach the world. That we are, meaning not to say we'll rest back on our laurels. You see, you know, like it's a tour guide of how wonderful my soul is. There's no obstacles to your soul expressing its purpose. It takes it to like it emphasizes relentlessly to like the extreme of there is no possible obstacle to your soul expressing itself in the world. That's what you have, and that's who you are. So there is no opposition to what you have to say in the world. There is no opposition to what you have to do right now. As soon as you say, yes, but, you're creating, you're pretending that there's some sort of opposition. You're creating a mirage that doesn't exist. You're endorsing a mirage. And then the same thing, by the way, the same thing if a person says, oh, you know, it's not necessary to do anything about this. When a person says nothing bad is going to happen, he's really, what he's saying to translate his words is he doesn't believe that he has the ability to, through his choice, to speak up, to actually turn around the situation. So he kind of just throws up his arms and says, that sounds very patriotic or very, confident. Oh, nothing bad is going to happen. But what he's really saying is, he's looking for an excuse not to have to do anything, because he doesn't really believe that he has the power through his soul, expression of his soul, to actually change the situation and change the outcome.
So it's very interesting what you're saying is that when it was part of people's belief that other people are anti-Semitic, which created a barrier, which made it more difficult to redeem those people. If a person doesn't underestimate that they may be dangerous. I mean, what was happening is that it could be one person out of 100 is going to be the tattletaler, and he creates the danger, and the majority of people are not dangerous. So we can't underestimate the danger. On the other hand, we have to embrace those people and address them directly, respectfully, and break through this mirage. Try to break through and saying, well, something wrong is happening over here. And I'm not speaking about anti-Semitism. I'm speaking about any dangerous ideology, which is not in line with the words that Hashem said in Torah.
And, you know, while we're not limiting ourselves to anti-Semitism over here, but it is a key, it's a key tool in the war. The portrayal that there is anti-Semitism is a key tool in the war against the Jews. Whenever you see,
you were speaking about the difference between that you shouldn't just say a threat is from anti-Semitism, because a threat could be from any ideology, yes, which doesn't match what Hashem said. It's dangerous in its own way.
Well, that was your point. That's an excellent point. But now it came back to you. So whenever you see the mounting drums of anti-Semitism, we have to know that the drums are the war against the Jews. Meaning to say, when they're now creating task force and commissions, that is the war against the Jews. When the president of the United States is coming out and say he's going to
The bandwidth is
anti-Semitism with 100 changes to the way the government functions and different agencies operate and stuff like that. That is the war against the Jews. It is not. Yes. Okay. Once I wait. Now, my point is that when you see people talking about the buildup of anti-Semitism is.
Sorry, your bandwidth is. I'm not hearing everything that you're saying.
Psychological warfare again. Not the guy who's sitting around that you believe that the anti-Semitism. That you, when you believe that there is such a thing as anti-Semitism, then you are the victim of the war against your mind. Did you hear that?
We're the victim against the war against our mind if we accept such a thing.
Right. If we believe that there's anti-Semitism out there, so I'll just say this one thing and then we'll pause for tonight. Look what's happening now. It really goes back to your farming thing. People, they take these Marxist agents who walk around saying all kinds of terrible things against the Jews and about the Jews, you know, about the Holocaust, and they protest outside synagogues. These are operatives of a Amalek to get the Jews to turn to the government for protection. And when you think that the whites out there are all white supremacists are everywhere and they all hate the Jews, you will avoid going into the rural areas. You're going to avoid going becoming a farmer. It's meant to reshape our thinking into staying in the concentrated population areas.
I just want to point out the fact that the Rebbe sent people all over the place, and let's take that further. It seems like the Rebbe wants people to be everywhere, all the rural places as well. So it really needs two things. People need to be spread out all over the place and have good connection with each other, that they can help each other through good communication. Like, both things are important.
Yes, and that's why you need to know, that's why the Rebbe's emphasis on teaching the non-Jews is so important, because you have a purpose in going to a town that has, or a county that has maybe 5 Jews, because you have a responsibility to teach all the non-Jews.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to just wrap up with one Torah thought over here. In Hebrew, when we say the Hebrew word nun shin, nash, means to fall down, like a nesher, the resh represents a head, that nesher flies down. That's what a eagle does. It flies very high and then it comes down and catches. So it's nesher. It flies down. It's a head that flies down. So what is a punishment? This is the word I heard from somebody, very interesting. The punishment in Hebrew is onesh. Ayin, which ayin means eyes. Nesh means to fall down. So a punishment is not a punishment. It's a wake-up call to tell the person that they are to look, that they have fallen in their level and they need to lift up. So therefore, a punishment need not be severe. As soon as a person pays attention that they're not really, that they're becoming aware that they have fallen from the level that they're supposed to be. And so therefore, as soon as they start to rise again, so there's no need for punishments. So punishment is just a tool of awareness where God is sounding the alarm for the person to look at his state and realize you could be higher. And the name for a person is, you could say Adam, a man, but there's also a person that's, so Adam is Aleph. Aleph is like the word aloof. It's above, it represents God. And Dam means blood. So Adam means a person is both divine and made out of physical blood. And when a person is a ish represents an emotional man, and it's spelled Aleph, divine, and the word yesh, there is. So there is divinity. So an emotional person, their purpose is to recognize divinity. And an enosh is a person that the Aleph fell down. In other words, a person's like sort of dropped his divinity, and they have become on a low level because they've lowered their divinity, and what they really need to become is a gever, a champion that's going to reawaken their divinity and become an ish and an adam. An ish is the person that recognizes divinity, and adam is a man that is intellectual and has divinity connected to his blood. And there's the word tzaddik. Tzaddik is a righteous person, and the kuf is like the English letter Q, but it is a kuf means a monkey, and tzad means sides, but it also means to catch, because the way you catch, if you're a hunter and you trap something, you trap something from the sides. So tzad is the side. You trap something from the sides. It's tzad. So a tzaddik means a person that captures the monkey. That every person has, and monkeys are very self-centered, and they don't have they don't have divine intentions. They have selfish, self-centered intentions. So if a person captures the monkey inside them, their monkey drives inside them, then they become tzaddik, righteous, and a proper adam, a person that recognizes their divinity. And with that, I'm going to wrap up this week. I hope you enjoyed our talk, our podcast, and have a great Shabbos.